Hi student, good morning to all. And today we are going to see a poem Ulysses written by Alfred Tennyson. And before going to see the poems, and now we will see the some difficulty words from the poem and the meaning of those difficulty words according to this poem, a glossary. Hearth, fireplace, barren, infertile, cracks, cliff, meat to give, dole benefit, hold supply, drink life to the lees, live life to the fullest. Actual meaning of drink life to the lees means drinking alcoholic beverages fully, that is lees. Lees, the meaning is sedimentation, something at the bottom of the wine bottle. And from that also some drop may be there, and that to be drunk. That's why here, according to this poem, live life to the fullest. Studying, moving rapidly because of the wind. Ides, a group of stars in the constellation. In the constellation, what the definite shape is called a constellation, there in the sky some stars. In that a group, that is Taurus, often associated with rain. That group is called a Taurus. If Taurus appears on the sky, it is symptoms of the rainfall. Then vexed, it is an archaic word, not now at use. The real word now is vexed. Vexed. The meaning is upset. Then peers, look closely. Gleams, shines. To rust unburnished, to let go waste, that is without being used, to let go waste while bad. Three suns, here three suns means not 3 days, 3 years. Then scepter, an ornamental rod carried by rulers. What the rulers have crown and etc. They are all called scepters. Then discerning, showing good judgment. Prudence, cautiousness. Subdue, conquer. Smite, strike. Then adoration, deep love and respect. Puffs, blows. Rot, beaten out. Frolic, play or move about. Vance, disappears. Furrow, mark made by the ship in water. Bars, outer ocean or river that Greeks believed to surround the flat earth. Ancient time the people thought that the earth was flat, but it is now proved spherical in shape. Happy Isles, a fortunate island. It's located in Pacific Ocean, popularly known as Greek paradise. Then Achilles, the greatest Greek warriors are called Achilles. And we have 70 lines in our poem. You know, all those 70 lines, a few words you may not know the meaning, and that is taken as glossary and written. Now we will see the poem. Ulysses, a Greek epic, a poem written by Alfred Tennyson. Alfred Tennyson was a British poet, born in England, 1809. That is the first part of the 19th century, and 6th August. And he lived up to 1892. 6th October, I lived 83 years, his background about his family. He was the fourth son among 12 siblings in his family, and their family had a mental sickness, and due to that and few of his brothers and sisters affected. About his father was a drunkard. Because of excessive alcoholic intake, he physically became unstable and weak and died in the early part of his education. However, when the boy was 12 years old, he was interested in writing lot of poems. He wrote 6,000 lines, epic like by his own when he was 12. By seeing this, his father affected very much and admitted him in a very good school. And after that, he admitted in a college, Trinity College at Cambridge. Then when he was studying there in college, his father expired of that over drunk. Then he come under his grandparents. Then there he met his friend called Arthur Allan, and with his company he wrote first poems, and it got a prize, Chancellor Prize there in the university in Cambridge. That was his first appreciation. The next, he published continuously in 1832 and 1833. Then in 1850, In Memoriam, a poem called In Memoriam, he published in 1850. In the same year, William Wordsworth died. William Wordsworth was the poet laureate of England those time. Then he filled that vacant, calling by Victoria, because it is Victorian age. In that Victorian age, he was the famous poet. Then from 1850 to until his death, 1892, he was the poet laureate of England, and some long years, from 41 to that 83 age. There, Queen Victoria once happened to read his poem In Memoriam after the princess death, Albert, Prince Albert. After reading it, he called Albert Lord Tennyson and interviewed him few minutes, and such a great deep intention has been given in his writing about death of his friend Arthur Allan. Then he started his career as a best in this British period, next to the William Shakespeare. For his quotations, first William Shakespeare, next Albert Lord Tennyson. His famous quotation is, "Men may come, the men may go, but I go on forever," is written in a poem, The Brook. And now we will see poem stanza voices. And before going to see the Ulysses poem, and we see the entirely all 17 lines is divided into three part. Ulysses, the king, the first, he is thirst of adventure. First part concentrates thirst of adventure. Then second part is handing over the position, that is king post, to his son. That is second part. And third part, he calls his fellow mates and age mates to go travel beyond this earth through some ships on the Atlantic Oceans. And this is how he divided his entire poem into three parts. In that, today we are going to see some 32 lines about the first part, thirst of adventure. I have not taken four line how it is given in your textbook, but I have not written like that. But up to meaningfully I have taken, which gives a paragraph meaning. The first, at a little profits than an idle king, by this still hearth among these barren crags, matched with an aged wife, I met and dole unequal loss unto a savage race, that to hold and sleep and feed and know not me. This first stanza, first 5 lines of the poem, it a little profits than an idle king. The first line says about little profits means no profit at all. Little means no, profit means gain. Then an idle lazy, just sitting lazily, saying that I am a king, it never gives him any good name. Why they still here? Here says where he is sitting, near a firewood area, after becoming aged wanted to warm up his body, among these barren cracks. Barren means infertile. And you know, the group, those who are sitting along with him, is like infertile rocks. Cliff means rock. Cracks, the word cracks means rock, barren rock. Matched with an aged wife, who was accompanying with him, his wife also aged wife, I met and dole, unequal loss unto a savage race. And what is there here? That unequal loss unto a savage, uncontrolled race. By sitting there, he is writing some poems. Matched with an aged wife, I met and dole. Here the met means to give, and dole means benefit. What is the benefit he is going to give? Unequal loss unto a savage race, that is uncontrolled race. He is writing some laws for the people, those who did not know, that to hold and sleep and feed and know not me. They did not about me. For them, all rules are framed and set by me, thereby sitting near a fireplace. In these five lines, the poet says about what is his age and what he is doing there near the fireplace, with whom, and then sitting there, what he is doing, framing laws for the people who did not know about him. Then what he comes to say in the stanza is not necessary thereafter. He wanted to go somewhere by handing over the post to his sons. The next, I cannot rest from travel, I will drink life to the lees. Until this we take, I am going my journey continuously, like what he had already journey some 20 years away from the land. Where he was 20 years away from the land, he was in a country called Troy. There was a war called Trojan War. After completing the Trojan War, he returned and looked after their subjects, and after then again he wanted to start his travel. I cannot rest from travel. That's why here says from travel. Already he traveled to the country of Troy for a great war called Trojan War. After 20 years he returned. Again he wanted to travel somewhere. A new land. I will drink life to the lees. Lees, sedimentation at the bottom of the bottle of a wine where we kept. Then here the meaning is, I want my life fullest. Live the fullest life. All times I have enjoyed. Here he says, in the beginning years, greatly. I enjoyed my life greatly and have suffered greatly. Not only enjoyed, and suffered greatly, both with those that love me, those who are accompanying with me, very near to me, and with them I greatly enjoyed, and also I greatly suffered, and alone, sometimes I was suffering alone by sitting in a lonely place, sometimes with my companions, it is on shore, and when through scudding drifts the rainy hiatus. Then he says, sometimes on the land and sometimes on the water. See, in the water, when he was traveling there in the sea, scudding drifts, he caught in the storm. There thunder and heavy rainfalls. And these drifts we measure showers, continuous rainfall. In that rainfall, but here that island, what already we have given meaning, Ides, a paradise of the great, the people said, there near that when he was travelling. And in this stanza, the poet says about how he want to live without rest. I don't like to take rest, but how should I live my life? Fullest. I should love my life fullest. Then this is how I passed my the previous years, that is with greatly have enjoyed and greatly have suffered, sometimes with friends and sometimes alone, and then sometimes on the land and sometimes on the water, even with the storm. In the second stanza, he says about the travel, and in that travel, he want to live his life fully, not interested to sit near a fireplace to warm his body and spend his golden age. Then he wanted to go graveyard and without doing anything. But my thinking is, I should live my life until the last day of my death. That is the poet point. Then, vexed the dim sea, I am become a name for always roaming with a hungry beast. Much have I seen and known cities of man, and then and manners, climates, councils, governments, myself not least, but honored of them all, and drunk delight of battle with my peers. For on the ringing plains of windy Troy, I am a part of all that I have met. The next. In the next stanza, the poet begins with the archaic word vexed. Vexed is the word, once it was in the usage, now it is extended. The meaning is vexed, that is upset. The dim sea, the dark sea, the light of the sea is, his life goes fade. He is becoming age. I am become a name, just a name, for that sake you are skiing, for always roaming with a hungry heart. That the man roamed entire world with the hungry heart, that is thirst. To quench his thirst, he traveled. Much have seen and known cities of men and manners, climates, councils and governments. In his travel, he met all these cities of men, different city people, and their manners, how they behave with them, and then country's climate, and then there the setup of government, the councils and governments, and all seen by me, and myself not least, by seeing them, how I ruled. I am not least, I was also a king that time, but honored of them all. I was most respected person of comparing all, and drank delight of battle with my peers. With my counterparts, I fought and conquered. For on the ringing plains of windy Troy, the Troy, what I have already told you, a country where the Trojan War was held 20 years. There you see here the ringing plains of windy Troy. He brings the meaning of ringing. In ancient time they used sword to fight. That sound comes in the plain area through the wind and reaching the place, that is Troy. There he brings the meaning, I am a part of all that I have met. I was once a hero in that war, I met and got victory. Here in his travel, he meets different country people and also climate and councils. There how they were respected people, and like he is not less, he is also respected person, and fought delightfully in the war of Trajan 20 years in the country of Troy. Then he was there a hero of the war. In the third stanza, he explains about himself, how he went to other countries and fought, and particularly he remembers Trajan war and the sounds of the wars, that is ringing. Entire plain is ringing in that sound in my mind, he says. Then we move to the next stanza. At all experiences an arch wear through, gleams that untraveled world whose margin fades forever and forever when I move. How dull it is to pass, to make an end, to rest unvarnished, not to shine in use, as though to breathe were life and life piled on life. And in the next stanza, he says, it all experiences, all his experiences of the war is an arch wear through. He went through an arch. There are several arch. Arch is a shape of the building where one can enter. He may say here, what is now waiting? The heaven is waiting. the torch, glimpse that untraveled world. That is, he did not travel so far. That glimpse, glimpse means what? Shines well, shines well, whose margin fades, but in the past are going on fading, but whereas in the beginning in the arch it is very bright forever and forever. When I move, and I move on this side, I get a bright arch, whereas in the para places which I have come across fades in my mind. How dull it is to pass by seeing that. Pause means here stop. It is dull to stop. So I don't stop my travel to make an end. It is not a place to take rest and ending my life. To rest unvarnished, not to shine in use. And whatever be the things we have not used, and that may be eroded. And here the poet takes the word rust. Here the rust means that erosion, not shine in use. If it is not used, that may go. That's why I did not stop my travel, as though to breathe were life and life filed on life. Here he says, just breathing is not life. Breathing is, all the living being is breathing. But a king just takes oxygen inside and leaving it carbon dioxide is not life. All the people are living like that. Life filed life. Life filed on life. So living, just a living is not mere life. Acting is life. The poet says, until the soul is in the body, we must act, that action should benefit in and around of us. In this stanza, he talks about the glimpse of the arches. And he is not liking to stop his travel, because taking rest is rest. Rest is rest, he says. And then he, just breathing is not life. And another point he says, life should be enjoyed up to that last day of our death. The next, where all too little end up one to me, little remains, but every hour is saved. From that eternal silence, something more, a bringer of new things, and while it were for some 3 cents to store and to hold myself and this grey spirit yearning to desire to follow knowledge like a singing star beyond the utmost bound of human thought. Where all too little and of one to me, little remains. You see, whether the little or the big, and all one to me, and little remains, and nothing remains, but every hour is saved, and all hour enjoyed and ruled, from that eternal silence. Eternal means it will be always, remain always, permanent. Silence, something more, a bringer of new things, introduce the new things, and while it were for some 3 cents, 3 years, to store and hold myself. You see here, and this grey spirit yearning. Yearning means a longing for something, to desire. He had a desire, and for that he is longing for something, that 3 years, 13 years. He is aged, he is going to die next. To follow knowledge like a sinking star. Sinking star means, star we know, hero, and here sinking is going to die after some years. Is aged like a sinking star and beyond that most bound of human thought. In the human thought is a hero, and the hero is going to die. And in this stanza, the poet says about that eternal silence, and all thing is nothing, that's a little remains, nothing will be remain. All hours what I have in my life used, then and brought new news, while it were for some 3 cents to store, hold. In his country, he wanted to be there 3 cents, 3 years. Aitiha is his country, that is, and which is going to be handing over to his son, to follow knowledge like a sinking star, then beyond that most bound of human thought. Here says, and before his death, before his death, the country should be left silently to his son. In the next part, we will see about that. Telemachus, how he rules his country. there in the beginning what we have seen today is glossary, and then author note, and up to 32 lines some explanation, but not entire summary. Entire summary will be given at the end. The remaining part will be seen in the next video.